Good morning, and welcome to Pilgrim Congregational United Church of Christ in Lansing, Michigan. This is May 3rd of 2020, and we are in this church season of Eastertide. Well, although progress has been made to flatten the curve in the number of cases of the coronavirus, there are still real dangers of spreading the disease. So we will continue to offer our worship services online on Pilgrim's Facebook, website, and YouTube. The worship services in the church building will be closed to the general public through the month of May, and the use of the building will be very limited. AA has begun meeting again with strict social distancing rules in place. The Pilgrim staff will be in and out of the building to take care of necessary responsibilities. The recommendations from our government changes with new information from the medical community. So this is our approach right now. We may have to make further adjustments, so please check updates via email or posts on Pilgrim's Facebook and or website. Pilgrim's executive ministry team has asked you to continue to send in via the regular mail or personally delivering your pledge or whatever donations you wish to make. When delivering personally, please put the envelope in the mail slot in the door, the side door on Eureka Street. The executive ministry team has also divided up a list of the members of the church to keep in touch with by phone, email, and or card. Each has a list of several members whom they will keep in contact with during this time of social isolation. And you who are not on the EMT, well, please keep in touch with some of our church people. Let us let the people know that they are not alone. Now let us begin our service. Let us pray. O good shepherd, please be with us to guide us and to give us comfort. You have brought us through many dark valleys in our lives, and we ask you to bring us through this dark time of pandemic, political uncertainty, and all the other difficulties we face. We pray to hear your voice guiding us to green pastures and peaceful waters. We pray for you to replenish our souls and renew our spirits. Lead us in the ways that you want us to follow. Let your goodness and mercy pursue us and overtake us so we may live with you always. Bless us now in this time of worship. Amen.
The 23rd Psalm is one of the most celebrated pieces of scripture in the world. Millions and perhaps billions of people have found strength and comfort in these words, which are 3,000 years old. It is 6 verses long. All 6 verses are a confession of the psalmist's experience of God, the divine shepherd. The first 3 verses speaks of God in the third person, while the last 3 verses speaks to God in the second person. In English, for nearly 400 years, the most popular translation was the King James Version. This is the one most of you know. Here is the 23rd Psalm in the King James translation. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
And now we turn to our call to worship. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, calls us to worship and to service. We are the sheep of his fold, and we gather because we hear his voice and answer. Jesus came to give us life, and to give us life in abundance. In the midst of the darkness and injustice of life, we trust in God's love and grace. God calls us to follow, even when the way seems harsh and treacherous. In the dark valleys of life, God calls us to have faith and trust that God will lead us through to the light of a new day. We hear God's voice call to us, and we follow our Good Shepherd. Amen.
Jesus is the Good Shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. We are the sheep of Jesus' fold. A shepherd watches over the sheep and cares for them. A shepherd will find food and water for them. A shepherd will protect them from predators and find a place for them to rest safely. The sheep will come to follow the shepherd well. The sheep will recognize the shepherd's voice from among other people's voices and follow. Hear the word from the Gospel of John, chapters 10, verses 11 to 18, and 24 through 30. Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd, does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep who do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. I have received this command from the Father." So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What the Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. And the Father and I are one." This ends the gospel lesson for today.
You know, in our modern world, not many of us are familiar with farm animals like sheep. But in the time of Jesus, 2,000 years ago, there were a lot of sheep, and they were a part of everyday life. The people who took care of the sheep, well, they were called shepherds. Shepherds take the sheep out into the fields of green grass so that they can eat, and they take them to streams or to wells where they can have water to drink. The shepherds protected the sheep and kept them from being attacked by wolves or bears or lions. And one of the most interesting things about sheep and shepherds is that the sheep can actually recognize the voice of their shepherd from anybody else's voice. Yeah, I heard a true story of three shepherds who met at a watering hole with their flocks of sheep. Now, this was witnessed by a journalist not so long ago. And after a while, when the sheep had drunk their fill of water, they all went their separate ways. The shepherds called to their sheep, and each flock followed their shepherd and not the others. Jesus said that he is our shepherd. He said that we are like sheep, and he is our shepherd. Jesus watches over us like a good shepherd to keep our souls safe from harm. Then he said that the sheep who belong to him hear his voice and follow him, not someone else. We may not hear Jesus' actual voice calling us to follow him, but he does want us to follow what he says and wants us to do. The best way that we can do that is by reading the Bible, especially the parts of what Jesus said, and pray to do what Jesus wants us to do. These are ways that we can listen to the Good Shepherd, Jesus, and learn how to follow him and not somebody else. So, let's go and listen for Jesus and follow him. He's the Good Shepherd. Amen.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. Please join Melanie and I in singing the words to "The Lord's my shepherd."
Let us pray together. O God, we declare that you are our shepherd. We seek to trust in your care and follow in your ways. We pray for your support and guidance when times are hard and life seems unfair. Help us to keep our faith amid challenges and heartache. May we remain in your grace and loving presence in the midst of the storms in life. Enlist us in your relentless reach into the world to drive out fear and to bring comfort to the afflicted. We pray that we will be faithful to your call to serve and love and to bring health and justice to the world. May your kingdom come so that your will shall be done on earth and in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, another reading of Psalm 23, this one from the New Revised Standard Version of our Bible. The New Revised Standard Version, the NRSV, is an English translation of the Bible published in 1989 by the National Council of Churches. It's a revision of the Revised Standard Version, which was itself an update of the American Standard Version. As you might guess, there have been many translations of our Bible, lots of them from their original languages to English. Now, words in one language, say Greek or Aramaic, may not be easily translatable to another language, so you'd be right in thinking that there would be differences from one translation to another. Sometimes those differences are significant, both in the words and the meaning underlying the words. Now, I read some commentaries on this psalm, and there was and is an occasional difference of opinion on what King David was trying to say. But I'm impressed that the words of this psalm, in the versions I'm familiar with, are so similar. So here is the New Revised Standard Version of the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. The 23rd Psalm.
Psalm 23 is perhaps the most comforting words in all of Scripture. And although the psalm mentions dangers and darkness and death, it is really a psalm of comfort, light, and life. It reminds us that even when our lives seem the darkest and death may be imminent, the enduring presence of our loving God is always with us. Now, the psalm starts out with a powerful declaration. The Lord is my shepherd. Shepherd's duty was to protect the sheep from wolves and bears and lions. The shepherd watched over and guided the sheep to make sure that they did not go astray or get lost. A shepherd provides the sheep with food and water. And in similar fashion, a king was to do the same for his people. Although the wolves, bears, and lions came more in a human form than an animal, and going astray might be more a matter of ethics and customs than of location. In other words, a shepherd was a metaphor for a king. Kings in the Middle East were often referred to as shepherds of their people. So what do we declare when we say, the Lord is my shepherd? We announce that God is our shepherd and our king. God is the one whom we put our ultimate trust for our well-being and care. We declare that when we are lost, it is God whom we seek for guidance. We declare that when we need sustenance and nourishment in our souls, it is God whom we will seek to fill our spirits. We declare that when we are threatened and darkness and danger surround us, we will find safety and comfort in God's presence. We declare that we have surrendered our lives into God's hands. We say, others may worship and follow a human being, like an earthly king, a president, a celebrity, a political party, but as for me, the Lord is my shepherd, and no one else. I follow the Lord. Having declared our ultimate allegiance to God, we go on to confess, I shall not want. Now, this is not a confession of a lack of desire, but rather it is a lack of need. Other translations put it this way: I lack nothing, or I have everything I need, or I don't need a thing. When we are in a right relationship with God, we have no needs. Or when we are truly aware of God's presence and surrendered to God's will, we have all that we need. We find that God's presence is what we have been seeking all along. All the other things like security and comfort, money, status, position, are all earthly things of secondary importance to God. Food and water will sustain us for a while. Shelter will protect us for a while. Well, money, status, and power are fickle and unreliable for our security and comfort. All of these things are earthly things, which you just cannot take with you. Only God provides a presence and power beyond the realm of this earthly existence. Only God is reliable to keep our souls safe and secure. With God, in verse 2, our souls experience a fulfillment like sheep do in fields of green grass or a lush meadow. The sheep are so well provided for and safe by the shepherd that they can lie down and rest comfortably with no danger. This peaceful scene is further reinforced by the shepherd leading the sheep to quiet pools of water. The shepherd takes his sheep to a place where sheep can safely drink their fill. God will provide our spirits with a safe and bountiful place where we will find life-giving refreshment. As it says in verse 3, God restores our souls. This verse, verse 3, might be better translated as God renews my life. When we are burdened with life's troubles and demands, when we are crippled by an overload of hurt and heartache, when we are overwhelmed by tragedy and trials, we seek out our shepherd, and God refreshes our spirits, restores our souls, and renews our lives. When life knocks us down, God breathes new life back into us. Now the rest of verse 3 says, He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Another way to translate this part of the verse is, God is true to his name and leads me along the right paths. Or we might say, the shepherd leads us along the correct trails to a safe and fulfilling place, because that's the way God is. God's nature is to always do what is good for us. We may wonder about the way or path that God leads us when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. There are many ways to translate this phrase. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, or the dark valley of death, or even if I were to walk in a ravine as dark as death. But the essential meaning of the phrase is profound darkness where there is a threat of deadly danger. As if the shepherd were leading the sheep through a dark ravine with steep walls, which prevents sunlight from shining down on the trail, and makes a terrible place for the sheep to be ambushed by a predator. We could even call such a place a death trap. In our lives, we all had to face times and places of deep darkness. We all have experienced a time when it seems like the walls were closing in, the shadows grew darker and deeper, and there was no place for us to escape. Some of us have had the devastation of losing a job or losing a house. Maybe you have had the heartbreak of divorce, the death of a parent, spouse, or child. Perhaps you have or are facing the shadow of a prolonged illness or injury. There are many valleys of death's darkness in our lives. Some of us have had darker experiences than others, but each of us has to bear our own pain. The coronavirus pandemic is like the world is walking in a dark valley in death's shadow. But we have much darkness caused by human intent as well. New struggles join with old conflicts. Tyrants slaughter their own people to hold on to power. And terrorism can strike at any time, from anywhere. There is much darkness of evil intent in human hearts, which make other people suffer. But Psalm 23 does not answer the question of why we suffer. It provides us comfort in times when we suffer. We walk through the valley of the shadow of death without fear of the deadly darkness around us because our shepherd, God, is with us. God knows the way. God sees in the darkness, as Psalm 139 says, "Even the darkness is not darkness to you. The night is as bright as day, for darkness is as light to you," which means God is not blinded by evil. We do not fear the darkness of unseen or unknown evil that there may be ready to attack us, because the shepherd's rod and staff are there to protect our souls from harm. A shepherd would carry a rod or a club and a staff or crook as weapons against attack. In God's case, the rod is compassion and the staff is love. Compassion and love are the best weapons against the dark evil around us. In verse 5, we change the metaphor, but not the meaning. "You prepare a banquet before me in the presence of my enemies." Although we are surrounded by evil, God protects us in such a way that we can enjoy a feast without fear of being attacked. We may have tons of hurt coming our way, but with our hearts centered and focused on God, it feels as though we are having a spiritual feast in the midst of our worldly turmoil. Next we read, "You anoint my head with oil." In ancient times, it was customary for the host to pour oil over a special guest's head. So that we might better understand this phrase by translating it, "You welcome me as an honored guest in your home." God does not casually or indifferently accept us. God embraces us in close relationship. God welcomes us with outstretched arms as the father of the prodigal son did to his wayward offspring. We are treated as an honored guest or as a child returning home. It all means that God gives us extravagant hospitality. God provides acceptance in a measure to fill our cups to overflowing. God's love and grace are so plentiful and abounding that there is no end to God's graciousness. When we think we have had enough, and you think there is no more to give, God gives us more. The sixth and final verse of Psalm 23 sums up what has preceded it in the psalm. The King James says, "Your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The word mercy is really loving kindness, which is an unconditional, everlasting love. So some translate this phrase as, "Your kindness and love will always be with me," or, "I know your goodness and love will be with me all of my life." But the word that really makes a difference in how we understand God's goodness and steadfast love is, "shall follow me." We picture old, goodness and mercy walking behind us, perhaps like an old fat dog. A wonderfully loyal but terribly sluggish old friend having a difficult time trying to keep up with us. And nothing could be further from the truth. Now, the word so often translated as "follow" is better understood, better rendered as "pursue" or "chase after." God's goodness and love are not plodding behind us, barely keeping up with us, but rather God's blessings and unwavering love is chasing us down and pursuing us. God is pursuing us like an Arctic wolf relentlessly pursues a caribou, mile after mile and day after day, until the caribou falls exhausted. God keeps after us, hoping that we will fall exhausted from running away. God is chasing us. God is pursuing us to give us goodness and love. But we keep running away, either in fear because we do not recognize true goodness for us, or because we are arrogant, maybe believing that we can do it for ourselves. We don't need God. God says, "Well, okay, go ahead. Run, believing that you can do it on your own. I'm right behind you when you're ready to admit that you need me." God's goodness and love are pursuing us. So let's surrender to it. Let's get caught. And when we surrender to God's goodness and loving kindness, we will know the presence of God in its fullness. "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever," is the sixth verse of Psalm 23. The New Revised Standard Version and others say, "I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long," which many people don't find quite as comforting. But the original meaning could be rendered, "I make my home in the house of God for all time to come." Many Christians and Jews believe that all time to come includes the eternity after death, and so forever. When we surrender to God's goodness and love and follow God's will, then we will live in the timeless presence of our loving God. And although we are mindful of the valley of the shadow of death in Psalm 23, the psalm is really about life and living fully, and we live fully in God's presence. God's presence is so full of life and love that even the darkest valleys of our lives, when defeat and death seem at hand, we need not fear the evil and the danger around us, because God is with us, keeping our souls safe and our spirits from failing. We may not realize that God is here with us in dark times, just as we are not aware that there is air all around us, upholding us, giving us strength, giving us our lives. So Psalm 23 reminds us that God is always there for us, to bless us forever with love and grace. Grace be upon you. Amen. Time for our blessings and concerns, and followed by our prayer for the day. And of course, what is on all of our minds is the coronavirus pandemic. And we have certainly prayers for that Many of us know people who have become ill. Some of us have even known someone who have died. And our prayers will certainly be going out to them and for the people of the world to be safe and to be rid of this danger and disaster. I know many of you have your own personal dark valleys that you're going through, and you are dealing with issues that you need some help with, some divine help, as well as some human help. Well, let's put them all into our prayer for today, shall we? Let us pray together. Dear God, we come before you, acknowledging that you are our shepherd, God. You are our King that we follow. God, there is none other, but there are many voices that call for us to follow them, call for us to be led by them. Help us, Lord, to not be swayed by their voices, but to listen for yours only. Help us, God, to always, not only in voice, but also in fact, have you as our shepherd. And we thank you, God, that you have sent the good shepherd to us, Jesus Christ, to help us and to lead us to the ways of abundant life. You have given us great green pastures and still waters so that we might refresh our souls. And you have led us in right paths if we listen to your voice. God, we thank you for your scriptures that help us to lead paths that are right and righteous. And God, we thank you that you are there with us, even in the darkest of valleys, even in the depths of the shadow of death. We thank you, God, that you do not abandon us or forsake us, that you are still with us. We know that, God, you keep our souls safe in your care. Yes, our bodies may be racked, our minds might be challenged, but our souls are always safe with you. And God, you are like a great shepherd. You carry a rod and staff of love and compassion for us. You have given us grace, and those things are such wonderful comfort to us. And you have prepared a bounty for us, God, even in the midst of the trials of life, in the midst of all the storms that we might face, both inside and out. You are there to keep us calm in the center. And you treat us, God, like a wonderful, honored guest. And we don't always understand the reasons why you are so gracious to us. But in whatever way, when we realize just how much you have done for us, we know that our cup has been filled to the brim and has run over. And God, we are grateful that you pursue us. You continue to chase after us, to give us goodness, to give us mercy, to provide us with love. Your wonderful loving kindness, God, is chasing after us, and we pray that we will just be caught by it all and stop running away. Well, God, there are plenty of people who are suffering today. They are ill. They have been injured. And they are in need of your healing power. And so we ask, God, for you to provide healing for them according to your will. We are in the midst of a grave pandemic, a dark time for many of us, dear God. And we pray to see the light of a new day, that we are freed from this disease. And so we thank you for the people who are caring for those who are ill and injured. We pray, God, for you to grant insight and inspiration to those who are working to find a cure or a vaccine. We lift them up, God, into your care. Help them to find the means to help us all. And God, we certainly do pray that we will live in your house forever. We thank you, God, that you have been with us, that you have guided our paths, and God, you have blessed us greatly. We thank you for the 23rd Psalm and its message to us. And so, God, we depart from this worship service in gratitude for all that you have given to us. Please, God, continue to be with us and be our shepherd. And this we ask in Jesus' name, who gave us these words that we might be as one in our prayers. And so we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, Jesus is the good shepherd who watches over us and gives us direction and purpose. Yeah, our final song sings of our fervent wish that Jesus lead us on as a shepherd would lead the sheep. We close with, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. God bless us all.
Jesus is the good shepherd who watches over us and gives us direction and purpose. Our final song sings of our fervent wish that Jesus lead us on as a shepherd would lead the sheep. We close with, Savior, like a shepherd, leads us.
It's been wonderful to spend some time with an old friend, Psalm 23. And I hope in this time you have found some comfort and solace in those words once again. It is good for us to review and to sometimes look at them once again with fresh eyes, seeing them as we would for the first time. Anyway, keep this old friend with you. There are times that it will be dark, but it is something that brings us comfort even in the darkness. And now let us conclude with a benediction. We have been visited here by the Good Shepherd, and the Good Shepherd will guide us through dark times and bring us to the light. And that light is God's love shining in the darkness of sin, in the gloom of misguided faith, and in the shadows of false hope. God is the only one who can restore our souls and replenish our lives. God's Spirit strengthens our spirits to give us hope and courage. God's goodness and love will pursue us all the days of our lives, and we will live with God now and forever. With God, our spirits shall be nourished, our thirst shall be quenched, and our soul shall be renewed. God bless you all. Amen.